We'll just start here.
What was that?
We'll just start here and just go from here.
Yeah, that'd be perfect. I hit record. What's up, everyone? It's your boy. We're back with another hopefully not messed up episode of Sick Days. And today I'm with none other than Danny Boy Smith. That's your full name, right, Danny?
Yeah.
The boy part is in the middle as well.
Yes.
Yeah. This man is a tattoo artist, and he loves riding bikes and motorcycles. And he's done pretty much every tattoo on my body, except for the little moon.
For the little moon.
Yeah, but you did these ones. Did the one on my ankle. You did the Doberman right here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's done. I haven't gotten anyone else because I love Danny. And he's a super cool dude, and I just wanted to interview you, dude. Like, how you been?
Well, not too shabby.
Yeah? What have you been up to?
You know, like I was telling you, I'm getting ready to do a cross-country trip.
Yep.
I'm going to... I've been thinking about this for like the last like 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to do a fully semi unsupported trip across the United States. So my job allows me to, you know, be mobile,
mm-hmm.
which I already am. I already travel a lot for work, but I've never like, I've done like single events, but I've never done like a full tour. So this is going to be my very first full tour.
So you tattoo, and so you're going to be going to a bunch of different tattoo shops and just like guest starring in there.
Exactly, like that's friends so of mine I've made over the years. I've been doing this for 27 years, so
that's
it's like
so sick.
I have friends all over the place, and I'm all like, why don't I just go see them all or as many as possible?
Yeah, that's dope. Know? Like, that's the dream. I want to do that with this eventually and be like, hey, I'm just gonna go to a bunch of people's houses across America and do a podcast with them. I think it'd be freaking awesome. One thing I was telling you earlier, like, why I wanted to start this podcast. You were one of the first people I want to interview in my head.
Oh, what?
When we got our, when you got me my first tattoo, when the hummingbird,
mm-hmm.
Talking to you reminded me how much I love talking to people. Cause I asked you so many questions. Like, I don't know how much I annoyed you that day while you were tattooing.
We probably knew each other better at the end of it.
Yeah. We talked a lot.
I always say tattooing is an experience. You know,
it was great. And you made it freaking awesome. But I remember I went home. And I legit thought I'd love to have a video of getting tattooed while interviewing you and trying to ask you questions while I'm getting tattooed, because I know I wouldn't be able to focus.
No, it gets a little trickier. Easier for me, harder for you.
Yeah, because I wouldn't know what to say while I'm going like, ah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you don't want it to sound like a porno. So yeah.
I got inspired because I listened to this one podcast where a dude, he went to, I guess, like a porno, he went to Dominatrix and interviewed her while he was getting tortured.
And, wow.
Yeah, so I was like, that'd be pretty sick in a tattoo version.
Yeah, I've talked to a couple of Dominatrix about their jobs.
How's that for them?
I've tattooed them. They love it.
Yeah?
They freaking love it.
And do they get, like, weird clients at all? Or?
Oh, yeah. What do you think's the first question I have? So I, unlike podcasts, and there are a few tattooers who do podcasts.
Yeah.
You can find them out there. And I think it's kind of cool. Like, there are people who are, all the stories that we tell and we've gone through, they're like starting to do podcasts about them now.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I've always like, I sit down with my clients and I'm always, you have some clients that talk, some that don't.
Yeah.
So I always start off talking. It's all, it also helps me find out if they're going to pass out on me or not.
Yeah.
But like, that was one of the things. I've tattooed a couple of dominatrix and I asked them, you know, what are the weird ones? And the weird, and it wasn't anything like too crazy, you know, like the, I think the infancy thing, like I'm a baby, spank me. Like, I always thought those were kind of bizarre.
Uh-huh.
But they had never told me anything, you know,
too crazy. Like, they get the mayor coming in.
Right, well, there might have been.
They might have been, but you know,
might have been, you know,
you never know. I think that's the crazy part. There was someone up in Reading who was actually on, I forgot what, I think it was the, My Weird Addiction or something like that.
Okay.
And he was the kind of dude who liked to be dressed as a baby. And treated like, he was put like in a giant crib and stuff like that.
Yeah, dude. And they hire moms to talk
that's
to
so
them
wild.
In baby language.
Pick them up. Pick ladies. Just
yeah,
pick
like pick up a 250-pound dude. Like,
oh, my God.
And burp them, you know.
Oh,
like,
my God.
I don't understand it. It's not my thing. And I'm not going to like pass judgment on it. But I'm like, yo, man, like. Therapy.
Yeah, right.
Get some therapy, dog.
Yeah, fetishes are like, weird.
Fetishes are weird. I like we talked about that with me and my girlfriend. Like, you know, do we have any fetishes? And I was like, No, not really. I guess we're kind of fucking boring, you know, but we've also lived like these lifestyles that were kind of crazy.
Yeah.
So
kind of get it out.
I feel like some people who have the fetishes mm-hmm. have these mundane lives.
Yeah.
And then behind the closed doors, it becomes a different thing.
That's where it gets
thing.
Crazy. Yeah. I think that's pretty common, huh? Like I think yeah. people do that.
Like accountants yeah. and yeah. politicians and
they get the, you know, weird stuff. Some people say it's like a power dynamic thing.
Yes. And so they want to switch the role.
Yeah.
They want to be on the receiving side rather than, you know, like the driving force. Yeah.
I don't think I have any weird fetishes. I definitely make people think I do.
Yeah. Like, no, I'm weird.
Yeah.
But I'm all like, you know, and I can get real weird, but I'm yeah. not that kind of
that
weird.
That kind of weird. Yeah, know? No, it's.
I'm more on the bizarre side.
Bizarre, yeah, bizarre things.
Just one, bizarre stuff.
One that really makes me laugh is the idea of a foot fetish.
Yeah.
Not because it's weird, but I don't know why. I've been coming up with an argument. 4 foot? 4 feet?
Okay.
I'm not into feet.
4 feet?
Yeah, 4 feet. I'm just like.
Just not 2 feet?
It's like, it's weird because people, like the idea of feet is gross, right? So you're on your feet all day and whatnot.
Right.
But it's like, at the end of the day, it's just another part of the skin. If someone keeps their feet clean, like, why are you opposed to it? I don't know. It's a weird argument. I'm not into it, but I could see why someone would be into it, or I can see why it's not too crazy.
There's fetishes for everything.
Yeah.
If you go into that world. Excuse yeah. me. I feel like when I was in Japan.
Oh, sick. You went to Japan?
I went to Japan. It was one of my dreams to do it. I went and tattooed in Japan.
Oh, no way.
And I remember all my friends were all, you have to go to the vending machine and get me some underwear. And I was all, wait, what? And they're like, oh, yeah, they have vending machines that have underwear there. And I'm like, so if you shit your pants, you can just go get a pair of underwear? And they're like, No. No, like girls' underwear.
Yeah, they sell their underwear.
They sell their underwear.
That's so wild.
And I knew people were doing that here. And mm-hmm. I have had friends of mine who've given, like, John Waters their underwear.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, John Waters is a weird dude, you know, like, and he loves that shit.
Shouts out John
especially
Waters.
Yes, I love that guy. Especially in public place. He's all about it, right? So John Waters, I'm like, fuck, man. Like, I grew up on his films. My mom was a huge fan. So I get that. But in Japan, that's a, speaking of, once again, we're right back to the, you live this lifestyle mundaneness.
That's very true. They do have like a
all right?
strict
so there,
lifestyle schedule.
When they go on the outside of things, you know, they always take their shit pretty far.
They do.
You know?
That's so wild to think about.
So when I was there, I went looking for these fucking machines and I couldn't find them. So I turned to my friend Hiro.
Yeah.
And he's all like, oh yeah, no, they don't sell, they don't have them out on the streets anymore.
Oh really?
You have to go to strip clubs to get them.
Oh,
so, but that was real. And he's like, oh yeah, yeah. They used to be everywhere.
Whoa.
So what would they, would a girl like have a box of underwear and just put them on, mm-hmm. take them off, clean pile, dirty pile, like, and
that's
just
so
like
wild.
Package them up. Cause they said you would get a little card.
Yeah.
And have a, like her stats. Well, I'm not quite sure what the stats are. Like I wanted like, to go
what
get
the
stat, a,
her pH level.
Like. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's like, what are the stats? You know, like I have no idea. Like, is there a bacon strip involved? Like,
that's
who knows?
So wild.
But everyone was all about them. My friends didn't want them because they were going to like sit there and sniff them.
Yeah.
And all, they
it's
just thought it was weird.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's
exactly.
a novelty. I don't know. Do you know who Belle Delphine is?
Who?
Belle Delphine. She was like this internet sensation. Like she's like kind of the girl who, I might be completely wrong, but she kind of got started with like the, she did like the anime girl face with her eyes being cross-eyed and she got really famous on TikTok and whatnot. Became pretty controversial. She ended
I'm
up selling,
sure if I saw her, I might know who she
yeah,
is.
Yeah, and she started selling her bath water. People would buy vials of their bath water.
Oh, I think I did hear about that
yeah,
part.
I wish I bought some of that bath water just to have for someone one day to walk into my house. It's like, you have that?
You have that?
Because she had to pull it off the shelves because people were starting to drink it. And they would start puking and get sick. And, like, you guys are
well,
fucking
dumb. Of course,
dumb.
There's probably, like, bath bombs
yeah,
and all the other, like, Epsom salt.
Yeah.
You just drank an Epcot.
But I wish I had one. Like, to have that in your house is just, like, a collectible piece of like whatever, you know. It's just, you know, it's weird. It's super weird, but yeah, man. I mean,
Oh,
that's so
wow.
sick you went to Japan. How long ago did you do that?
This was like before my mom passed, so it's probably been like 8 years now. No, probably a little longer, like 10 years, I think. Yeah, I was only there for like 2 weeks. But it was cool because I've done a lot of traveling by myself, you know, especially going to a foreign country where you don't, you know, speak the language. And don't let your friends like lie to you when they're like, oh yeah, when you're in Tokyo, everybody speaks English. That was complete bullshit. Like I got there and no one spoke English. The guy I was with, the business, how Tokyo runs their tattoo shops, mostly Tokyo, maybe the rest of Japan, but in Tokyo I can speak for. You have the front man who's the main artist, and then you have the businessman who's behind the scenes and he runs the whole shop. And the other guy's the, you know, the one that'll be internet famous or
It's like a
everyone knows.
partnership.
Yeah, it's like the partnership. So it's which I think's actually really smart.
That's probably the smartest way to do
No, it's like artists are terrible businessmen. And it's like
it.
I wish that here, you know, I'm not going to say anything about my shop, you know.
Can we say where you
But
work?
what's that?
Can we say where you
Oh
work?
yeah, I work at Red Room on Nord.
Shouts out Red Room Tattoo.
And but it's like every tattoo shop I've worked at that has an artist running it has its
And
problems.
that's usually what happens, right? It's like a artist opens up a lot of times, not all the time, but there's usually an artist that opens up on his own and then just tries to figure it out, right? It's kind of like with skateboarding,
Some
like
of them, fall into it. I know that the owner of the shop I'm at now, Dylan, he fell into it to where someone else was like, "Oh my God, this place!" Someone I think folded their shop and they ended up buying it.
Oh,
That's
wow.
what you always try to do. You
You try to
always
buy out a
try to
shop.
buy a shop that already exists because you can change the name and all that. People just remember that building over there
That's smart.
had tattoo shops in. It's just that's old as the hills. They've been doing that for at least 100 years. Like always buy an old tattoo shop.
Just like rebrand it.
Yep, and just rebrand it and redo it, and then you're back out into the world.
That makes sense. I might have
So
to,
that,
if I ever open up a skate shop, I'm gonna look, if I do it
yeah,
again, I'm gonna look for a shop that's like
buy out
buy out,
one that was already there
and be like, hey, you
because
guys closing
everyone else
down?
will remember it. And then you know sometimes you know I can tell you so many times like I talk to people because I constantly have the same questions I ask everybody. It's like, oh, where'd you get that tattoo? And they're like, I don't remember. It was somewhere down there on Polk Street. And then I'd be like, oh yeah, that was probably, you know, blah blah blah. Or if you're over here, it was so and so. I know them, but they don't. But that, and then I was all, oh, now I get it why they're saying buy an old shop.
People remember that
Yeah.
location instead of the whatever the sign is.
Yeah.
That's
So it's
sick.
like, yes, people do fall into that, but in Japan, they totally run it differently. And the business guy, like, is the business guy,
That's sick.
you know. So Tanaka, who I was working with, and like, his English was pretty good, but it was like very proper.
And how'd you meet him?
I met him. Oh God, I don't have to start using people's names. I'll leave it out. I had a friend in a band, very well known, and he went into partnership with my friend Hiro out in Japan. And this is before me and Hiro knew each other. And he was like, "You can come out to Japan." I was like, "Oh hell yeah, I'm jumping on this opportunity." That's on my list of things to do in my life, you know, like this is to go to Japan. So I went ahead and I went and talked to some other tattooers I knew who'd already been there. Because I was like, well, if you're going to do something you've never done before, go find someone who's done it. Ask them how they did it. And one of the key things that my friend Juan Puente told me was like, get a weekly mansion. I'm all, what's a weekly mansion? So it's like a, it's kind of like a renting a room, like at a, like, it's like a, almost like an apartment building, but it's like a hotel, but it's not a hotel. They have no services there. So when you say like you go for a month, no one's going to go into that room and clean it the whole month you're there.
It's almost
They
like
won't step
renting
in.
an Airbnb apartment style thing.
Almost, yes. Until you're done, then they come in. And the bathroom, I'll get to that. It was hilarious. But he told me about this. He goes, it's really cheap. Because this is what I do. And it's in the garment district. I forget what they call it. It started with an A. So I went and I got that. And I remember getting it for, I got it for the entire time I was there. And I think I spent like $600.
Oh, wow.
For just under 2 weeks.
That's pretty good.
Which is like in Tokyo is unheard of.
I was about to say, because the inflation like in Tokyo is crazy, right?
Oh, it's crazy. So like my buddy who's in the band who's got money to burn, you know, he went and rent a hotel room.
Yeah.
And I think his was like three to four times more.
Wow.
Than what I was spending.
Yeah.
Right. So, but he's like, you know, they come out. So I get there to the Weekly World Mansion. Of the Weekly Mansion, and I get there, and he told me, Juan's all like, okay, two things you need to know. First thing, it's going to be full of Japanese businessmen or businessmen from other Asia countries and European models. And I was all like, what? Why the models? He goes, you're in the garment district. So they use the models for the garments. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I wander in. My terrible Japanese, his terrible English, we figure it out. And I'm looking around, and sure enough, yes, there's short Japanese businessmen and these super tall, really skinny European girls.
That's it was the way such it goes.
The bizarre
That's
combo.
So funny.
I was like, look, they're either really tall or really little. You know? And I was all like, God damn, dude. These chicks are as tall as me, if not taller.
Yeah, and you're pretty tall.
They were huge.
You're
I'm like 6'2".
Yeah.
And these girls were like as tall as me, if not taller.
Wow.
And they were super skinny. So being that I'm there, I'm all like, all right, I'm going to try to act like a Canadian or a European.
Yeah.
You know, because the Americans stuck out like fucking sore thumbs.
That's what I hear.
So the second thing he told me, he goes, look for the 7-Eleven. So I was all like, what? He goes, it's going to become your friend. I was like, all right. So I went wandering down the street, and sure enough, like about a block and a half away is a 7-Eleven on the corner. I'm like, okay.
That's funny.
Noted. Remember, 7-Eleven.
Yeah.
Which came into play later, you know. After that, one of the other things I did is I went to McDonald's. McDonald's. And I don't eat fast food.
Yeah.
But they were like, you have to go have one of the burgers at McDonald's. And I walked in. And the first thing I notice is like, this is like a 2 to 3 story, very narrow. All the buildings are really narrow. They remind me of like New York, like, you know, shotgun style. Like they're really narrow and really tall, but it's about as wide as this room. And it was really tall and it went back.
Wow.
And on the walls, like ceiling to floor was like this graffiti artist, Norm. Like these huge trains with all his names all over it.
That's dope.
And I knew the dude from like when he was just coming into tattooing and Grime was showing him how to tattoo. I became friends with him when he was a piercer. And that's why I think like Juan said, you got to go to.
Trying to get connected.
Yeah, to get me in there. And I walked in. I was like, oh, what the fuck? Like, holy shit. So you're seeing all this artwork. And Norm did huge like rollout style stuff that was like, you know, 2 stories tall and like, you know, 150 feet wide.
Damn.
They were monsters. So I get there and there it is, like this giant stuff, and which later on I asked him about that and he goes, oh yeah, they kind of stole it. They took it off photographs of trains and buildings.
Whoa.
Because they made the wallpaper.
Whoa.
Out of it, but he goes, I kind of let it slide.
Yeah. Because
he tattooed at this same shop.
Okay.
And he went there and stumbled into
his own art.
His own art. And was all like, what the fuck? I think he did get paid out of that. But I remember I was like, I too wandered into the same place. It's like, what the hell? So
that's interesting.
The shop itself was like second floor, no sign, barely art on the walls. And you know, because I forgot that, oh yeah, Japan, like you're tattooing, even though they are the forefathers of modern tattooing, it's extremely frowned upon. So like when I first got there, like the guy who I won't mention, like was all like, yeah, man. Like, and he's heavily tattooed.
Yeah.
He's got shit like right on his forehead. And he goes, all right, man. So there's places we can't go.
Yeah. Okay. So I remember I would watch a lot of documentaries on like Yakuza and stuff like that.
Yep.
And Japan, it's the one of the ways. Law. Yeah. When they crack down and they're like, hey, tattoos, no go.
No go.
Yeah. Like full body fits. Yep.
There was
more.
A lot of no gyms, no pools.
You couldn't
no
even open a bank house, account.
No. Like none of that. Yeah. And he goes, and it's pretty funny. So we were standing there and he's telling me all this. And he goes, and you're going to find people staring at you.
Yeah.
And we're not talking like on a subway side eyed.
Yeah.
They're going to like just eyeball and look at you. And
you're
6'2",
you're American, you're full of tattoos.
Yeah. And, like you're some weird American covered in tattoos. And I didn't have my head tattooed on. The back of my head and neck was done, but not the top of my head. So as he's telling me this, like this 15-year-old kid's come tromping down the street and he sees us and he stops. And I remember him planting his feet and sticking his arms out and just sat there and stared at us, like dead stop. And we're talking and then I kind of looked over and I looked back at him and I'm all like, what's happening? And he goes, hey, pal, what can I do for you? And the kid just turned around on the side street and went running.
Oh my God.
And I was just all like, and I looked at him, I was like, oh, is this going to happen like all the time? And he's like, oh, no. That's a isolated incident. He goes, they do stare at you, but you're not going to see that. That was kind of weird.
He probably just heard myths of men covered in tattoos. He's like, my mom just told me to stay away from
just
you.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I don't know what happened. And like, I don't know if he recognized him from the band or something.
Yeah.
But he was all like,
he was shook, dude.
Like he was like frozen.
Yeah.
There, just standing there frozen.
Yeah. And they're still pretty strict with it.
They still are. They're cracking down even more right now.
A friend of mine,
he
wants to teach overseas in Japan. He wants to go to school, be an English teacher and teach over there. But he's like, he has one or two tattoos, but he's not going to get any more specifically to avoid the whole situation. So I'm like, hey, you do what you do. That's a trip. Like it is. When I first started getting tattoos, I got really into once I started doing something, I like to get into the history of something that I do. Like one of the reasons I got my septum was because some of the Mayan tribes, they would get the septum and kind of try to do my research on stuff. So I did a lot of tattoo history research and learned about the Tabori tattoos and stick and poke and all that cool stuff. And it's really interesting that like Japan having some of the most painful looking technique, plus one of the most like demanding techniques on getting tattoos, and they're like just shutting it down. It's just crazy to me to think that they're doing that.
They invented the color.
Did they start color?
There was no color before them.
Oh wow!
Every tattoo was black.
It was all tribal black ink style, huh?
And then their composition, where like Sailor Jerry became like kind of like well known because he realized he like looked at American traditional and Japanese and was, oh shit.
Yeah.
We're almost doing the same thing.
Yeah. The bold lines.
Yeah. Bold lines, heavy color, leaving skin.
Symbolism.
You know, and he was one who's like, oh, even though he was pretty racist. We'll be open about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, he was part of World War II, so.
So it kind of stems from that
Japanese,
era. Yeah, that's. It's hard
say
to
say some fucked up shit.
It's hard to think about anybody who's been like a pioneer in something, and you got to accept the fact that they probably said some racist shit.
Yeah.
Like some of my favorite. Well,
like
musical
back
artists.
When he was saying that racist shit, everyone was saying
that
racist
shit. Especially in a war with another country, too, like you're not going to be nice to the country who just hit Pearl Harbor. So it is what it is, but at least we have American traditional. And what do you think about Neo-American traditional?
I like it.
Yeah.
I don't do it. Mm-hmm. I steal aspects from it.
Yeah.
I mean, that pretty much came out of like part of like what New School was in the 90s.
I like New School because I personally don't want any New School tattoos, but I really do enjoy that. A lot of them look like Yu-Gi-Oh cards.
Yeah, well, they also, like, everything was warped and twisted.
Yeah.
Like, especially when I got into tattooing, like, in the late 90s. It was in full fucking swing.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I could draw that crap, dude. Yeah. I'm like, I'll just smoke a fuckload of weed and just be like, whoa, dude.
Yeah, everything was extra cartoony.
Everything
huh?
was really cartoony. But the theory was still there, was these big fat lines and tons of color. And the problem they were doing, though, and the guy I used to work with in Let It Bleed in SF, like, you know, and he'd been tattooing for a long time, longer than me. And he was like saying, he goes, look at my arm. I got these tattoos like back in the early 90s. And they used all these pastel colors, really soft colors. And some things didn't have, you know, because we like to say black is like the skeleton, you know, that holds the tattoo together. And the color is like the muscle and the tissue. So even if all that fades away, you still have a skeleton. A lot of these guys were not putting black outlines around certain things. So then when all the color over like 15 years or so fades away, depending on how much you're in the sun, your body type, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Like all of a sudden you look at the tattoo and you're like, what is that?
Yeah. Like it just spreads out and bleeds away.
I can't tell because like, well, they were using these super soft colors and they'd put two of them. They were like, you know, like a Easter green next to an Easter yellow.
And
you're like, oh my God, those are super pastel.
Yeah.
And like those lighter colors just fade away. So where in the more traditional stuff, it was just heavy, you know, like whack, whack.
Yeah, heavy reds, heavy blues.
And then you're like, you look at some old sailor dude who did not put lotion on it, who did not do all the things we say to do. They didn't care. And then he worked out in the fields forever. And then, you know, yeah, that tattoo of the hula girl looks blown out, but you go, that's a hula girl.
Yeah, you can still see it.
I can still see it. And he's still like, yeah, I can make her dance, you know, like. You know, still to this,
I say that about the heart. I can make a beat. Yeah. I'm glad I got that one. That's so sick to think about, like, the transitions of, like, tattoo form and the art that goes into it and, like, what it's evolved into today. I mean, I don't know a lot about it. I imagine you're always being updated, whether you're into it or whoever comes to the shop.
I am updated, like, obviously with trends and so forth.
Yeah.
As far as, like, deep history, I'm not the best at it. You know, like, I got a lot of my friends who read all the books, remember the names and dates and who and where, what, when and why, and then I'm all like, I just tattoo because it's, you know, it's fun, and I like drawing and making things, and yes, I look at stuff, and yes, I will always attribute to where I got the idea from.
Yeah,
you know, but I, you know, I can't sit here and tell you where, you know, like how Zeus like pulled this history from so-and-so back when he was so-and-so in the Bowery, and it was back in 1954 and there was the ink battle, blah, blah, blah. And that shit really happened. I mean, yes, I've read a couple books, but I'm not like a like good a
scholar.
Historian.
Yeah. A scholar in tattooing. Yeah.
I did a talk once at the Jewish Museum in San Francisco. And it was a lot of, like history kind of stuff. And I was all like, oh, fuck, man. Like, I'm not the best at this shit.
Yeah.
So I'm all like, so I talked about subcultures
and
tattoos. Because I was like, well, I'm part of the subculture. So I'm like, I can talk about that.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what I got up and I talked about, you know, like, you know, punk rocks and skaters and and all the other scenes and everything. And I talk primarily like Bay Area because that's where I was from. And I told everyone, this is what I'm going to talk about because it's what I know.
That's the way to do it.
Yeah. So what, keep with what I know.
What got you into tattooing? I remember you told me a while back.
I kind of fell into the job.
Yeah.
It's not like now where, you know, kids are like, first of all, back when I started, you could not just order online.
Yep.
There was no online.
Yeah.
You had, there was two supply companies, National and Spalding and Rogers. And in order to order from them, you needed a sponsor to bring you in. So someone had to vouch for you to do it. Right. So for me, I started getting tattooed in the late 80s. My first couple tattoos were stick and pokes me and my friends would do. And then I remember my friend was like, oh, I'm going to this shop in San Jose and I get tattooed by this guy. And I was like, oh man, I really want to go, but I'm only 17. And he's like, if you just come with us, like just stay in the back. And he doesn't really check IDs. He's an old dude.
Yeah.
So I went with them and I just flashed money, just held out the cash. I was like, I want that one.
Yeah.
And I flashed money. And Pinky's wife, who was the dragon lady, was all like, snatched that money out of my
hand.
That's
so funny.
And I knew, I'm in.
Yeah, that's so
great. She didn't even bother. Like, there was no paperwork. You could drink and smoke in the lobby. Like, this place was old school. So
yeah.
I didn't learn who this guy was until later.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, it was just like, there's this old school dude. And the other shops I've stuck my head in at that time, like the very first shop I stuck my head in was Phil Sims shop in Belmont on El Camino. This is like mid 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And I stuck my head in and I looked at possibly Phil. I don't know who it was. But they had a gun on their hip, right? And I saw like biker flash or like swastikas. And I was all like, nope, fuck that, out. And I walked out. But I was young. I was probably like 15.
Yeah.
And the second shop, which was Goldfields on Broadway. And I used to go to shows, this place called Mahube Gardens across the street. So like before, we would always go up early. We know, because China Banks was right down the way.
Oh,
so
dude.
That's where we used to drink. I would skate China Banks during the day and that's drink so under it at night.
That's so sick.
So China Banks was our spot in Barcarolle. I can go into all the spots, the dish,
HP ramp. I got to skate around in Barcadero last year, and I loved it. I loved every single second.
Yeah, so like, I always joke, like, I skated in Barcadero when all the corners look like this.
Yeah, when there were sharp corners.
This is like 84, 85. So anyways, I used to go to these shows, and across the street was this place called the Metal Shop or Metal something.
Mm-hmm.
And it was where all the Heshers, the long hairs.
Yeah.
They go buy their big spike bracelets and stuff. But right next to it was Goldfields. And Goldfields was one of the second, at the time, was the second oldest shop. Pitcher Machine was the first.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember wandering in there, and he had this really big lobby. And I looked around. I couldn't see anything. I was like, oh, okay. So then me and my friends started wandering farther inside and a little farther and looking around. And then we just heard this big boomy voice. Hey, you fucking kids, get the fuck out of here. And we're like, oh, and we all like ran out into the street, you know, went to the show, you know, which it's funny because years later I did a painting for him. What, you got outside? Is that the cat? You stay out there.
That's so funny.
Yeah. So I did a painting for him and it was from the Mahube Gardens.
Yeah.
Looking out on the street and there's like a fist fight and drunk sailors and punk rockers running everywhere. And Goldfield was like, this guy knows what's up. You know, this is the way it used to be. Cause it was like, we used to play the game of stealing sailors' hats, you know, like a lot of us did it, you know, which was dangerous cause we were kids and they were grown men.
Yeah.
They'd beat the shit out of you, you know, but like, those were like my first shops. So to go to like Pinky Yun down in San Jose, like that's where I was just like, I got my foot in the door.
Yeah.
You know, so I was like, okay, well, I want to get a tattoo. So I got a bat on my shoulder, which has been covered since then. Like my first couple of tattoos, like I was like 17. I was like, hell yeah, I'm doing this, you know, because at the time, like I was hanging out with all these other dudes and they were like, they were tough and I wanted to be tough too.
Yeah.
And it's like late 80s. And if you want to look tough, get tattoos because no one had tattoos.
Yeah.
So I got my first couple there and I would start to go like every week. Every weekend we'd fucking go down and it was just gangbangers and bikers and us. And you end up spending the whole fucking day there.
That's so sick.
So, and you could smoke and drink in the lobby.
No one's going to stop you.
I would just sit there and read, look at all the pictures of all the people. And I was like, dude, this guy's got like a lot of stuff in here, you know, I didn't think about it. So I come to find out later as I went into the tattoo world, I remember being at the shop and these guys were going through this book. They're like, oh yeah, no way. Oh yeah, no way. I was like, well, what are you guys looking at? He goes, oh, we're looking at Pinky stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Pinky Yun. And they're like, oh, you know who Pinky Yun is? He goes, yeah, I got tattooed by him. And they're like, what?
That's
like,
so dope.
Yeah, dude, I got my first like 12 tattoos from that guy. They're like, shut up. I'm like, no, this dragon on my arm. Like, I bought it for like $75. Like, and just did the line work. And he did it in like 15 fucking minutes.
That's so dope.
And they were like, no way, you got a tattoo. But he was blind. I'm like, I know. He was an old dude, you know. He never talked. He never, ever talked. So I remember I got this one tattoo. I was really into this band called Rich Kids on LSD, RKL, like skate punk band from
that's
the
so sick.
From the 80s.
You're in the trenches, and, huh? Like you heavily support the punk scene and
oh yeah, into all, it, I was so deep in it. That's why I said like love subculture. So
yeah.
That's what this melting face of the melting face of Beanie yeah. Boy came out in their album, and I think it was 88. It was the beginning of 88, and it came with a comic book. And I was like,
that's so sick.
Dan Seitz, who was the artist for that band, like I loved his drawing style. So I totally stole a lot of stuff from Dan.
Yeah.
Because I liked the way he drew, and it was really cool. So I was like, oh, I'm going to kind of steal that. Yeah, I steal a little from him. I steal a little bit from Robert Crumb, Jack Davis, all these different artists, comic book or illustrators. So I saw that, and it was like the scene where the dude's face is melting. So I saw RKL play the year before up on Broadway, which I was talking about earlier.
Yeah.
And one of my buddies, we were like this little skate crew, and he's all, yo, man, like, I got some acid, right? And we've all done a bunch of acid. We did it at school. We did it everywhere. And it was like, it's Bay Area. It's the 80s, dude. We all did.
Yeah,
acid was cheap as fuck. Everyone else had to pay tons of money, but we were like, the factory was literally across the bay. Like, it was being made right there.
Oh, shit, that's
Berkeley.
Right.
It was all coming
that's
out of
right.
Berkeley.
You were getting fresh made.
We were
acid.
Buying it for, yeah, it was fresh as fuck. And we were buying it for like 50 cents to a dollar.
That's a trip.
Like, that's it. You know, so we had some, he got this stuff. He goes, oh, I don't know what this is. These are kind of big, so we're going to break them in half. Turns out it was four-way window paint. So it's like, quadruple dipped, you know, fresh.
Yeah.
And we all took it. And we all took half. We're like, oh, we'll do half. We'll be fine. And I remember one of my friends telling me, he's like, if you're going to go to a punk show, I'd be a little like, I don't know if you want to take acid at a punk show. It gets a little wild.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah, I can handle this shit. I've eaten acid in school, dude. Like, it's cool. So I totally go. And we go see them play. And they finally come on. And I'm so fucking stoked. And I get up into the pit. And it's the very first time I've ever experienced slow motion in my life. I was in the pit and it was just like moving super slow and like everything, like a movie, everything was moving. And then I looked up to the band and they're playing like normal. But back in the pit, everything was, and I was all like, I jumped out. I was all, whoa, what the fuck was that? And I was all, oh, that was, oh man, this is starting to get a little intense, man. And I'm all like, I think I'm going to make it to the door. And I start to walk out and then someone like grabs me and is pre-Danny Boy. So they're just, yeah. Dan, hey, Dan. And I was all like, hey. And then I was talking to him, and his face just starts going, wah, 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 wah. And it turned into the melting face of Beanie Boy. And I was so just dumb. All like, bah, dude. And I ran outside. And as soon as I run outside, I look over, and there's Morgan and Tim and Pete Colpitz and all these dudes that I knew that we all did acid together. Yeah. And they're all outside against the wall. And we all looked at each other, and like, and I'm like, bro. And they're like, we know. And I'm like, okay, well, what do we do now? And like, we ended up driving around my friend's like old Thunderbird car.
He was able to drive on acid?
Yeah. It was like, it was not as intense as being in that punk show.
Like, he felt safer.
We felt safer driving around all
the
night.
The hills of San Francisco.
Yep, in San Francisco. And we did it all night until like, I don't know, they dropped me off of like wee hours in the morning. And then I couldn't sleep and, you know, went to school, I think, the next day, like, fucking
still
sleep
tripping?
Deprived. Yeah, a little bit tripping. God. Like, it's like, oh, it was the 80s, man. Yeah. It's like how we lived our lives.
That's so sick.
But that's why I wanted the melting face of Beanie Boy on me, because I actually experienced the melting face of Beanie Boy. And I was like, on acid, seeing rich kids on LSD. I'm not rich, you know. I was like, you know, the poor kids on LSD, you know,
like,
be the sub band. But it's funny because they're just about to go on tour, but most of the original members are dead. So
I'm
not quite sure how they're doing that.
Yeah. But is the vocalist still alive?
What's that?
Their vocalist still alive?
No.
Oh, damn. They're just like subbing like three people or what?
Yeah, they're subbing like everybody. Well, everyone who's been in that band throughout the years, because it morphed so many times.
Oh, okay. So they're almost doing like a tribute type
thing?
Yeah. So
they've
pretty cool.
Pulled everyone together, and it's like all my friends are going to go, and I'm just all like,
not gonna be the same.
I've seen
experience.
Them play so many times, dude. Yeah, like, I love them. They were one of my favorites, you know, but I don't know, it'd be just kind of weird without, you know,
all the
seeing Jason
teams.
On stage. Yeah. You know, like, oh, I don't know, it's all right. Maybe next time I'll catch them, you know.
Yeah. Dude, I can't imagine. Like, the most I've done is smoke weed. So I couldn't even imagine what it's like to be tripping on acid.
Definitely weird. Just it's right up there with trying to swim in the ocean on acid. I did that too. That
What?
got really weird.
Like in San Francisco or like
Yeah,
somewhere else?
well,
Like
down
the
Pacifica. We were in Pacifica
Okay.
actually.
I was
And
about to say that
we
it's cold, dude.
this, oh, it's
It's
really
so
cold, but you
cold.
don't notice it as much.
Yeah. You're on the acid, you're
I
like, man,
actually
this
thought the water was
was warm.
boiling and it
Oh
kept
my
jumping
God.
out. And
That's too good.
and we found my friend Tim, who I was like said earlier was with us. Tim Arthur, he disappeared from us and we were like, oh my God. And there was like, I don't know, like six or seven of us, and we went looking for Tim and we found him down the beach and he had his face in the sand, almost like he was dead. And we're like, oh fuck. And we were all freaking out. We run over to him and he's just sitting there and he's slowly but surely like wiping his face, like, he's wrapped up in a blanket and he's laying face first and he's just slowly doing this with his head. And
Just
we're
feels the
like,
comfort of the sand.
dude, what are you doing? And he's like, I am the bulldozer of life. Each one of these grains of sand is a planet. And we were like, oh, okay. And then he just takes a big bite of fucking sand. And he looks at my friend and just goes, poof, just spits it all over him. And he's all, it's the Big Bang Theory. And then we fell on the ground and laughed for like half an hour.
Oh,
So it's
that's
like.
so dope. That's dope. So like those instances got you introduced to like tattooing into like getting tattoos. And
That got
then
me into tattooing. So
how
we can
long till
fast
like
forward at that point, probably like another 10 years.
I was just
And
getting tatted up.
I was getting tattooed. I got tattooed in a shop a lot. And then later on, I became a bike messenger in like 91. I was living in Santa Cruz out of high school. And that's when I would go to Pinkies all the time. And all my friends, we all had tattoos, our whole crew. So when I was all like, man, I'm done with you guys. I'm going back to San Francisco. I moved back to San Francisco and then randomly ran into another dude I knew from the peninsula and he was a bike messenger. And he's like, what are you doing? And I was like, oh, I'm looking for a job. And he's like, well, what do you want to do? You want to become a bike messenger? I'm like, well, what do you do? He goes, you pick stuff up, drop stuff off. Talk on a radio all day. And I'm like, fuck yeah, I want to do that. I totally got hired as a bike messenger and I didn't even have a bicycle at the time.
How'd you get a bike?
I just lied. I just lied through my teeth. It was like this one company called Express Messenger. They're long gone. And they hired me only because I had a friend. Her name's Elka from the band Trash Women, and her dad was a dispatcher. And we were friends, and she knew my homies in Santa Cruz. And that's how we became friends. And then she's like, my dad's a dispatcher.
That's six. You got the hookup on
So I
him.
got the hookup, and I remember at the interview, like my friend Mike told me, is whatever you do, bring a pen. Just make sure you have a pen, which obviously in the industry later, yeah, you always have to have a pen. I carried like six or seven at a time. Because you had to have people sign your manifest, when you proof of delivery. So I remember like going to this interview and the guy asked me a bunch of questions, do you know the city? I'm like, yeah, dude, lived here all my life, like been in and out. I didn't go to school here, but I lived here, and he's all like, all right, so you know the streets? I'm like, yeah, totally. And I was all like, yeah, I knew the streets. I'm all, oh, go to that building, make a right. When you're in this building, make a left. When you see that old burned out car, that's, make a left there. I knew everything by visual sight, but I didn't know the names of the streets. I also did not know that odd and even are different sides. I also did not know that blocks would run in like, there's the 200 block, the 300 block, the 400 block. So if you looked at a number, 432, oh, 432, that means it's probably at the beginning of the block and it's going to be on that side. Right. So it was like, I didn't know any of that shit. So, and they hired me. And I remember there was a girl there who I never figured out who it was, but when she walked in, they were like, oh, hey, what's up? They knew her by name. And I think she had like red hair. And they're like, oh, the fastest girl in San Francisco. And she's like, yeah, just looking for a job. And they're like, oh, yeah, we don't even need to do an interview. And you got a job. They knew who she was. And then they look at me, and then he leaves the room. It's just me and her. And she looks at me. She goes, so what you riding? And I was like, oh shit. And I'm like, no. I don't even have a bike. And I'm all, I don't know. I go, like, Schwinn 12 speed or something. And she, like, looked at me and did the, okay.
Normie.
Like, she's just all a fuck poser.
Yeah. You know?
And I was. I was so green.
That's
and
so
I,
funny.
I remember, so that winter, the winter of 91 was an El Nino. So my introduction into being a bike messenger in San Francisco is I rode a fucking El Nino winter.
That's crazy.
With no rain gear, nothing.
Oh, no. That's so weird. Cause, so she was called like the fastest girl in San Francisco?
Yeah.
Did she turn out to be like some legendary bike rider or something?
She was. I guess she was like from at one time. Like.
Yeah.
And I've...
Sounds so like she has some crazy backstory.
My girlfriend Megan was also a bike messenger for about the same amount of time. We both were on the road at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
We found each other later in life.
Oh, cool.
But she was on the road at that time. And I remember asking her, who was it?
Yeah.
And she goes, I don't know, because that would have been just before me.
Yeah.
So we've not been able to figure out who she is.
Wow.
We have it nailed down to like three different girls who were on the road. There wasn't that many. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Is I thought it'd be easy to figure out because the ratio back then was like one to five.
Yeah.
Five dudes to one girl on the road. It was mostly dudes.
Yeah.
You know, because it was a little bit of a gnarly job.
Yeah. Out in the rain, out in the heat.
But it was, you know, we used to say the bicycle is my office in the city, you know.
Yeah.
No, the bicycle is my desk and the city is my office.
That's pretty sick.
And I was like, and when I got this tattoo on my arm, that was me saying, I'm never going to have an office job. Never.
That's so
never going to do it, you know.
Yeah.
So I went into this industry and it was all artists and musicians and like just a bunch of weirdos, you know.
Yeah.
And later on, I remember I had a buddy of mine. His name was Jesse Perrin.
Mm-hmm.
And he was this dude I knew from another crew of my friends but he was from Hawaii. And he like came to town. He needed a place to stay. And we were friends. Well, come stay with me. And he'd been tattooing, I think at that point, about 5 years. 4 years, some change, just under five. So he came and he tattooed. And I remember he was trying to draw a flower for my girlfriend at the time. And I was watching him. And he's, it is pre-internet and you know, all that stuff. Like,
yeah.
You had the when you made stencils, you had to hand cut your stencils. So I was all like, man, give me that piece of paper. So I took the paper from him and I drew the flower and handed it back to him. He just looked at me and he's all, what the hell are you doing riding a bike for a living? I don't know. I'm just kind of stupid. Yeah, that's why we do this job. And he's all like, have you ever thought about tattooing? And I was like, I've thought about it. I go, I have no idea how to get into it.
Yeah.
And he's all, well, I can't really give you an apprenticeship because a proper apprenticeship, you should have a job at the end.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, but I'll kickstart you. He goes, if you're willing to learn. And I was like, fuck yeah, dude. Like, because at this point, I think I've been messengering for like, probably about the 7-8 years, and I was getting tired of it.
Yeah,
you know, I was like, you know, I rode through like 3L fucking Ninos. Like, it was just day in, day out, and it wasn't as much work and blah blah blah. So I was like, career change, and I'm like, you don't want to be 30 years old and be a bike messenger. So I was in my late 20s. So I'm like, I better make a change now.
Yeah,
you know. So he started teaching me, and I remember in the very beginning, it was like, I'm like, cool, when do I tattoo? And he's like, we're going to talk about keeping things clean and this and that. And it took like months before I was making needles and doing all this shit that was so boring.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, let's get to the good shit, dude, you know. And then the time came, goes, okay, we're going to get you a machine. I'm like, oh, sick. And I was all excited. We're sitting at a table like this and he brought this box out. I was like, oh, this is it. And he takes the box and he flips it over and lifts it up. And all these parts come flying out and roll all across the table. And I was like, what the fuck? And he's all like, all right, build it. I'm like, I've never built a machine in my life. And he hands another machine. He sets it there and goes, look at that one and figure it out. I'm like, you're fucking kidding me.
That's so sick.
So I put the machine together. It did not run, you know. And then he's like, okay, now take it apart. I goes, okay, now I'm going to show you how to do it. And I understood because I had already touched it and messed with it and did all these things. So I was like, oh, that's why you did that.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So then he's like, okay, so then we're down like, you know, it must have been like 7-8 months. And he's like, okay, we're going to do your first tattoo. And I'm like, oh, really? All right, cool. And I'm like, so what am I going to tattoo? Like an orange or like a chicken skin or like a melon or something? He goes, no. He goes, you got a lot of dumb friends. Bring one of your dumb friends over here. And I was like, what, really? And he's like, yeah. I went, my very first one, I'm going to tattoo someone. And he's like, yeah. I was all like, he goes, look, man, is a melon going to tell you you're hurting it?
Yeah.
Is a slab of chicken going to move around while you're working?
Yeah.
You know, is any of this stuff, like, it's not real. Like, that won't work.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, we need a person. Mind you, Jesse was taught by this dude, Clay Decker, both on Hawaii, in the same neighborhood as Sailor Jerry. So their standards was all of the really old school.
Mm-hmm.
So they were just like, no, it's all straight up knuckle style. Like, nope, you're doing it this way.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, all right. So I found a dumb friend, still tattooing him to this day.
That's so sick.
Yeah, he gets the special price.
Yeah.
Because of, does he have that first tattoo? Fuck yeah, he still has that first tattoo. He loves to point it out.
It's
fucking shitty as hell. You know, you can still kind of tell what it is.
Yeah.
But like, he still has it, and I still tattoo him to this day.
That's a homie.
Like Ben Thompson.
Shouts out.
Also
Ben
a
Thompson.
Bike messenger from DC.
Shouts
so,
out.
Yes, so he, so I brought him in and I tattooed him in the middle of a fucking party at the house. So there's people everywhere falling all around. But one of the things I got from being a messenger was I was able to tune things out around me.
Yeah.
And I still have this skill to this day where I've had people stand next to me and almost yell.
Oh,
and
my God.
I don't hear them. I just tune it out.
Huh.
So I'm in the middle of this party, and my first like couple of years of tattooing, I wore a bandana because the sweat pouring off me. It was like it was so scary. It was so frightening because you're just like, and he was like, you're not going to do good tattoos for a while. Just
accept the fact.
Just accept the fact. Just do it. Just do it. Do it. Do it. Give them away. Give them away. Trade and give away. And he goes, you got the perfect group. You have a whole group of bike messengers, you know, who don't give a fuck like you.
Yeah.
Just do it.
Yeah.
And he was right. So, unfortunately, right after my first fucking tattoo, something happened back in Hawaii. And he's like, I'm sorry, I got to go back to Hawaii.
Dang.
So he like left me. And I remember his parting words. We're still friends to this day. He's now on the mainland. He was also a big white dude who spoke pidgin. So he sounded... You close
like
your eyes and you thought you were talking to a Samoan.
Yeah.
You open your eyes and it's like a big white dude. I'm like,
that's
whoa,
so
that's
funny.
Weird. So he like was like, get an apprenticeship. You need to get an apprenticeship. Otherwise, no one's going to take you seriously. He left. I was very arrogant. And I'm like, I got this.
Yeah.
I'm just going to make this happen. So I tattooed technically a scratcher.
Yeah.
For a few years. And I just tattooed all my messenger friends. And over time, I began to notice that my tattoos were not advancing, if not going backwards.
Mm.
And I was like, what's happening? What's going on? And I had a buddy of mine, Jason, who worked at Picture Machine. And I remember going over there. He was finishing his apprenticeship. And I met him through another like messenger I knew. And I remember buying a machine off him, and, you know, I got this Mike Malone, which was like one of my still prized machines.
Yeah.
And I was all like, hey man, like, can I ask you some questions? And first thing I said is like, I feel like my tattoos are getting worse. And he's like, well, duh. I'm like, what do you mean duh? And he's like, well, you're not immersed.
Yeah.
He goes, you need to put everything into it. You need to put your life, your soul, live, breathe, eat shit tattoos, dude. Like, you need to be in a shop.
Mm-hmm.
You're not in a shop. You're trying to do it on your own. Some people can do it. They might be naturally talented, pick it up, and off they go. But not everybody. Mm-hmm. And you're one of those not everybody's. So he goes, I would get an apprenticeship. He goes, you have to. And I'm like, but I've already been doing this for a while. And he's like, doesn't matter. You're still back where you were, mm-hmm. even though it's been a few years. And I was like, you're right. So I had just split up with, at that time, my wife.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I think I just turned like 30, mm-hmm. and I was all like, how am I going to grovel at 30? You know, so I was all like, well, fuck it. You make it or break it.
Yeah.
Now's the time. I was tired of being a messenger. I was a motorcycle messenger at the time. Mm-hmm. So I was, you know, anywhere from Sacramento to Santa Cruz. I was like bicycle, but yeah. like way faster yeah. traffic. And it was even more dangerous. Yeah. And I was all like, okay, I have to quit being a messenger and do this. So I got out of the business. I became a bicycle mechanic and then put my little book together and started. I was like, I'm just going to go door to door. I don't know wow. what else to do. I get tattooed by people. I know people. So I went to like people I knew and got all the doors slammed in my face.
Yeah.
To come to realize that San Francisco is one of the hardest cities to get an apprenticeship in.
Oh yeah.
And you're like, everyone. You're in a small pond with the biggest of the fish of the industry.
Yeah, dude. How many legends come out of San Francisco?
Yeah. So I'm all like, to me, what I heard was, so you're going to do this. And I'm all like, well, I'm going to try harder because if I make it here, I can make it anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So I went ahead and I kept, and I, it's funny because all these people, some people who slammed their doors in their face, some people were really nice to me and were like, you've never worked in a shop. And I'm like, does it show? And they're like, yeah, it shows. I'm all like, yeah, you're right. I've yeah. never worked in a shop.
Yeah.
I'm all, I'll scrub your floors. Yeah. I'll fucking clean the bathroom. I'll answer the phone. They're like, yeah, sorry. We already got counter help, you know. Yeah. But they were really nice to me. And it's funny, those people that were all nice to me, I'm now friends with,
mm-hmm.
which was really kind of crazy because they were well into their careers,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I was behind them. But now, like years and years later, like I remember when I finally got in, which I'll get to, when I got into it, I was at my very first convention as the counter help. And one of them walked up and saw me and they're like, oh my God, how are you here? And I'm like, oh, I'm apprenticing under her. And they're like, oh, Miss Mickey, fuck yeah, dude, you made it right on. And they were very supportive.
That's dope.
Right?
Yeah.
Because they knew that I sat there and beat the streets for like a fucking year.
Mm-hmm.
Just asking and asking everyone. I remember like FTW in Oakland, like, mm-hmm. you know, Jason there, I was all like begging him.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, bro, I just opened this place.
Yeah.
You know, I made him their very first t-shirts and everything. And yeah. he's like, I'm sorry. You know, yeah. he's like, this is, you know, I have this to deal with. I can't show someone how to tattoo because the process is long.
Yeah.
So I, you know, luckily for me, what happened was it was just, I met this woman who's my, you know, my mentor now, through some other friends, and we were hanging out in the Mission District and playing pool and everything. And then I became friends with her, but I didn't quite know who she was. I just knew she was this elusive kind of person,
mm-hmm.
heavily tattooed. And, eventually someone was all like, oh yeah, that's Miss Mickey. And I'm like, mm-hmm. yeah, I know. And they're like, no, she tattoos. I'm like, oh, she does? And they're like, yeah, she's at Sacred out in Oakland.
Mm-hmm.
So I was all like, oh, really? So I was like thinking, I'm like, oh, maybe I can somehow, you know, and skirt my way in there. So I went out to the shop and I went through her portfolio and I fucking shit my pants. Cause I was like, oh my God, this is like the stuff I see in the magazines.
Yeah.
Cause back then you were like always going through the magazine. What's the newest style? There wasn't no internet or nothing.
Yeah.
You know? So you're like, it was all about the tattoo magazines. And I've also found a couple of magazines with spreads of her and mm-hmm. other things. And she was one of the early females to travel, you know, United States and Europe,
mm-hmm.
you know, like the earliest of the Americans, like going over to Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And she's tattooed with some of the best. So I was all like, I turned to my buddy. I'm like, dude, don't tell her I tattoo. And he's all like, what, really? And I'm like, don't tell her. And he's like, all right. You know, because a long time ago, scratchers, like I used to be, you get your hands broke.
Dang.
Someone finds you scratching in their town, they'll fucking kick the shit out of you and take your stuff away.
I imagine because it gets competitive, right?
It's competitive. Well, you're also fucking people up.
Yeah.
And it's making a bad name for tattooing.
Yeah.
And I was like trying not to do that, but I was also trying. You know?
The weird thing about that, sorry to interrupt the story.
No.
The weird thing about that backlash of being a scratcher, a lot of people that I've heard who are really good at tattooing, they all started off that way. A lot of people more or less start tattooing on their friends or on themselves, and they learn, and then they get good enough, and then they go to tattoo shop. It's like, it's an unavoidable way. And I know they have courses for tattooing now, but I also understand that some, that's frowned upon. Like, it's a weird medium of, like, you kind of have to keep it hush-hush till you're good enough.
Yeah, I mean, I know a lot of people, and they all, I found out afterwards, probably why people were being nice. But took that path that I did. Probably I took a little longer to get there. You know, I always like to say I did a lot of the don'ts of tattooing.
Well, that's also a way to learn.
Tattooed and tattooing. Like,
But that's like one of the best ways to learn.
Well, yeah. I mean, because there's going to be things from all that time, like doing tattoo parties and stuff before, like, I was in a shop. Like, tattooing and parties and things like this. Like, I had to, like, make things. Like, oh, I don't have an armrest. I'll take that paper towel roll, this saran wrap, and that chair, and I'll makeshift this little thing, and then the person can put their arm on it. And I'd be at a convention, and and someone's like, oh, I don't have this. Well, here, check this out. I'm like, I whip it out and hand it to them. They're like, whoa, what the fuck? And I'm all like,
kind of
like, you know, tattoo parties. Like, tattoo parties. If you were a kitchen wizard like me, you had to make do with a lot of stuff. You had to figure it out. You know, so there was something that came out of it, you know, eventually. And it was the fact that I could, like,
be resourceful.
Yeah. You know,
that's interesting to think about it. Did you, I'm going to tell you something right now. So I'm sorry. I really wanted to get into tattooing at one point in my life. Literally after you gave me my tattoo, I loved it. I fell in love with, I'd have more tattoos right now if I didn't open up my skate shop and fall into debt and have to pay so much money to the IRS now that every penny I pay goes straight to paying off my debts. Like, so tattoos are non-existent for me right now, especially having a daughter. But
yeah,
I always hear stories about people with their, like, getting almost like their first tattoo machine, or how, like, a tattoo machine falls into their hand. It's always such a weird story. I wanted to get into tattooing, and I know I did not have the time to actually put it in, and I could not take the chance of going to, like, trying to find an internship or anything like that. I never tattooed anybody, but I did buy a machine at one point. I got the classic Amazon Dragon Hawk.
Sweet.
It's a $99.99 deal. You know what I'm saying? Five packs of needles, beginner's ink. And that part, like,
did you almost tattoo yourself?
I have not tattooed myself.
Oh, okay.
I still have the machine tucked away in my closet, untouched. I practiced on things. I practiced on oranges. I learned how to make skulls and flowers. I got used to it. I got, because I'm not a good artist either, but I love the medium. That, I think that's what attracted me to it, was like the idea of having something permanent and the connection that, I know it sounds so cheesy to say, but I love the idea of, like, older tribes earning their tattoos, or it's signifying something more powerful. And, like, for me, it sounds weird to say, but getting a tattoo to me was more of appreciating my ancestors. Because a lot of times when I read things about tattoos, it was villainized because colonizers came and they saw them with tattoos and they were considered savages. And it placed the thing on a culture, like Hispanic culture, like, your parents are still like, don't get a tattoo.
Oh, yeah. That was,
even though generations before that, everyone had tattoos
and
tribes.
My mom was from Nicaragua. So, like, when I came home, well, when she figured out, by then I had 5-6 tattoos. And when she figured it out, it was the dragon on the arm. And she was all, in my country, only whores and thieves get tattooed.
Like, there was this crazy thing to it. But, like, I love the idea. It's almost, not only is it a rebellious act in, like, your current societal thing, but it was almost like a fuck you to the colonization. In my eyes.
And here's the funniest part, is in the 14, 1500s, all those people that were going to the indigenous places to get tattooed were the extreme wealthy and rich.
Yeah, it's
they were the only ones.
Such a weird thing.
in like Europe who had tattoos, and it was a sign of like, look what I can do.
You have luxury and like,
it was luxury. Yeah, like, you had to be like, we're talking like dukes.
And yeah,
people who were like within the things. You know, yeah. They were like, and they were tattooed head to toe. They would just go get blasted.
That's a trip to think about. But the thing I wanted to tell you, it was like, it almost manifested for me. I told my dad that, like, because he was like, you got a tattoo? I'm like, yeah. It's like, you can get more? I'm like, yeah. Like, if I can get as many as I want, I will. And I told him, like, Dad, I want to try to learn how to tattoo. And this is like 3 years ago, like when you gave my tattoos. And he was like, why not do it? Like, he's always wanted to get tattoos, but he never got them because he had kids and he didn't have the money and stuff like that. Right. It's like, you can tattoo me. And it's like, he's just being a super supportive dad, right? And I haven't ordered a machine yet. And I get a call from him. And I totally thought he was just being a good dad and trying to support me with whatever I do. Because he always bought my t-shirts I made. Mm-hmm. He was there the day opening of my skate shop. He's a good man. And he's like, hey, I found something. You want to come and check it out? And so I go over to his house. And he shows me this bag. And inside the bag is a tattoo machine. And I totally thought he bought it to support me, right? And I was like, Dad, where'd you get it? It's like, some random skinhead probably threw it in our orchards where we work. I'm like, there's no way. It's like, yeah, look. And he shows me a tattoo machine with a swastika carved into it. And a pair of glasses with swastikas carved into it. With fresh needles, wrapped ink, like everything. And I was like, holy shit, like, the universe just gave me this tattoo machine for whatever reason. And I never tattooed anyone with it. I didn't use it at all, but I still have it as just like a piece of, like, if you really think about it, the universe will almost like bring it your way.
Manifestation.
And I, from that point on, for at least like 6 or 7 months, like every night I practiced on the orange peel or something with that machine.
Yeah.
And I used my Dragon Hawk. I never even actually used the Dragon Hawk. So it was like the Dragon Hawk was, I think it was a rotary one. And
a pen. I think Dragon Hawks are pens.
Yeah. I think it wasn't an expensive one. So it was like a cheap rotary. Mm-hmm. And the other one was a coil. But I try to get used to the idea of using the coil. It's so much shakier. And so I use that one to practice a lot. And it just, I don't ever think I ever see myself becoming a tattoo artist, but I think I love the medium enough to practice it in my own home. And then if eventually I want to tattoo myself, I'll try it out.
That's where we all start.
Yeah.
Oh, except for me, I tattooed Ben Thompson.
Yeah.
Afterwards, I tattooed like myself. So
yeah,
my all the tops of my legs.
You did that on your own.
There's so many times. Well, that's what he told me to do.
Yeah.
Number two was this one, was an old Sailor Jerry.
That's so sick.
Tattoo, and it looks like I got it tattooed in like the 1940s because I blew out every fucking line.
But yeah, it's always something I've wanted to try, and like, I even remember when you guys were hiring at Red Room for a desk person.
Yes.
I would almost apply to that. Like, the only thing that stopped me was that I needed a full-time job, and I think it was like 13 hours a week. And I know it said no guarantee for an apprenticeship or anything. I was like, I didn't care.
Yeah,
I just wanted to be around the environment. And
yeah. Well, that's how it starts.
So yeah.
We have a shop apprentice right now.
Mm-hmm.
This guy, Jaime.
Mm-hmm.
He's Utah Latino.
Yeah.
And he came as a counter help, and I remember him telling me, he's like, I want to learn how to tattoo. And I was like, all right, rule number one, shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
Shut your mouth. And the rule number two, start drawing every day.
Yeah.
Every fucking day you have to start drawing.
Mm-hmm.
And in a year, if you're still here and everything works out, you never know.
Yeah.
Your timing might be good, but you have to jump through these hoops first.
Mm-hmm.
And he did. He listened to what I said, and he drew, and I showed him. I realized he did not know how to draw that well.
Yeah.
You know, but it doesn't mean anything. Like, my drawing style completely changed when I started tattooing. There's some other tattooers I remember, they were just, we called them tracers.
Yeah.
They didn't know how to draw. They could trace, they could tattoo like a motherfucker, but say, the drop of a hat, here's a piece of paper, draw out of your head draw me a pig. they would have a hard time.
Yeah.
You know, they couldn't do it.
Yeah.
You know, but they have, if you have plenty of reference, you're fine.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what he did. And then sure enough, you know, like the owner, because I can't give him the apprenticeship.
Yeah.
Because it's not my shop.
Yeah, it's not your place to
like,
do it.
The first guy, Jesse, he's like, I can't give you this apprenticeship. So I, you could say I like primed him.
Yeah.
So do this, do this, do this.
Gave him the advice, you know?
And I was all, yep. And I was like, I steered him in the right direction. And when the time came, the owner was like, hey, man, what do you think about him? And I was like, yeah, I've actually been getting him ready for you.
That's so sweet.
So he's like, cool. So like, funny enough, now I'm teaching him the stuff.
And really?
Like, I've only helped out two other people in my entire career.
Mm-hmm.
And both of them were partway through an apprenticeship. And something happened. Like my friend Allie, she works at FTW Oakland, full circle again.
That's so crazy.
The guy who was teaching her got shot.
Oh, shit.
And lived. Got shot in the back of his head, Devin Blood. Me and him worked together at Sacred in the early 2000s. And the night he was over Oakland and he was moving out of Oakland, and someone broke into their warehouse and they thought it was the weed one. The weed one was next door, and they freaked out and fired blindly in the door. Oh. And he had his back against it, caught a bullet in the back of his head. So that her apprenticeship went out the window.
Mm-hmm.
And my friend Matt House, he was going to pick it up and help her finish. And then he scored a job at Spider Murphy's in San Rafael, which is what we call a career shop. So
yeah.
You know, that's like, you get a job there, your career is set.
Yeah.
And he was like, I'm sorry, I can't teach you.
Can't pass up.
I can't pass this up. So she was just left out in the lurch, and she was literally like 3 months from finishing. So like, we took, me and my friend Eric, we're working at Mom's on Hate Street, and we took on her wing. So, okay, what do you know? And like, she could draw, she could do all this stuff, but she didn't know how to make needles.
Mm-hmm.
So we taught her how to make needles. We showed her some machine stuff. And said, you know, like, there's not much else we can do. Like, let's just find you a job. So we called our homies out in Vallejo, and we're like, all right, you know, go talk to Pops and see if it goes. And I tried to help her as much as I could, gave her, you know, said, just call me whenever you need that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the second one is my friend Zach. Both of these people I showed, like, both tattooed today.
That's sick.
And do very well. And the other one was Zach. He was a sculpture guy, came out of SF Art Institute, and really wanted to learn. He was our counter help. But I would see all his drawings and his sculptures, and everything he touched was just like, holy shit, dude. Like, you're diving into this all the way.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And he was the other person I considered and started to kind of show him when I was at Mom's. But I quit Mom's and went to Let It Bleed.
Mm-hmm.
And Eric there is like, we can't have an apprentice here. Like, we just opened the shop. That doesn't look good.
Yeah.
When the shop's been here for like 10 years, then you can then, do it.
Yeah.
You know, but as a new shop, that's like, that's a no-no. And I was like, yeah, you're right. So I was like, sorry, Zach. So my bad. You know, I kind of started getting the ball rolling. But the good thing was then everyone at the shop, he became kind of a shop apprentice. And that's what Jaime is now.
Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't have like a one mentor.
And that's honestly sounds like a much better way to learn. You're learning all these different styles from people.
It is and it isn't because we all tattoo a little different.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone has their own unique style.
So we have all our different styles. So I think right now, you know, he's kind of adhering to like two of us, you know, and two to three of us. And our shop's like set up, the youngers are on one side and the olders are on this side. So he stays on our side of the shop for obvious reasons. Yeah. And I'm like, is there stuff to learn from those guys? Fuck yeah. That'd be like when you met me early in the days when I was doing all the don'ts.
Yeah,
you know, like, you know, yes, you can learn from the don'ts. You can learn from the mistakes. You can see the things that other people do and say, don't do that.
Yeah.
You know, there's things I pointed out. See that? See what just happened? Don't do that. And he's like, okay, you know, like, and he's watched me turn down tattoos, you know, he's been there like the whole way. And he's like a little sponge, and that's the way you have to be.
Yeah.
But like, and I told him, just don't do what I did.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're, I go, if you're fucking around with some shit at your house, stop it.
Yeah.
No, stop tattooing, start drawing.
Yeah.
Because that's the most important thing. So, you know, I gave him some painting lessons and he's already excelled.
That's so sick.
He's excelled like almost overnight.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And it was because he had no technique.
Yeah.
But he's like, you didn't show me. I'm like, I know. Well, why didn't you? I want you to struggle.
Yeah. I mean, you.
I want you to like.
If you really want it. Try to
figure it out.
Yeah. And if you really want it, you're going to figure that out.
Yeah.
I remember I have a book. I still have the book. And what I did is on my breaks at work and my free time at home, I'd go through the book and I would trace the line on that rule paper, trying to give myself a steadier hand.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I've gone through that whole book and I still have it. And I would trace all those lines and then I'd practice shapes. And I didn't work with shading or anything like that, but I just practiced bold shapes and simple shapes until I could do it without thinking. But it's fundamentals are important. And I think like that goes like everything, though.
That's everything.
Everything, fundamentals everything. And technique.
And that's what I told him. I was like, look, man. Even if you don't get an apprenticeship, mm-hmm. you're from here, you're going to walk out with some skill.
Yeah.
A skill you can use for anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's, and to me, that's the most important.
Yeah.
You know, before you even pick up a machine.
Yeah.
You know, like, I've known guys who came out of some, like, the career shop. There was someone there who, he worked there for 4 years. His apprenticeship was so long, the longest one I've ever heard, like 4 fucking years before.
It's all high school.
But he had him like, yeah, he had him painting flash.
Yeah.
And I remember even before he started tattooing, I saw his flash, which flash is like artwork you see on the wall. Mm-hmm. When you walk mm-hmm. into a tattoo shop, you're like, I'll take 4B.
Yeah.
You know, that's like, we call that flash. So his flash was like beyond what I was doing. I was mm-hmm. all like, holy shit. I'm like, you painted this? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, are you tattooing yet? And he's like, no. And I'm like, when you start tattooing, dude, you're just going to go. Pew.
That's sick.
And that's why he did that.
Yeah.
So when he did start tattooing, you know, I felt like mine, like, you know, my friend Little D told me, he goes, 10 years, bro. Unless you're naturally gifted, 10 years. So I remember like, those first 10 years, I was always like, ugh.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I still grumble at all my tattoos. But that dude, like, literally, like, it felt like a year,
mm-hmm.
less than a year. And his shit was just like, holy shit, so good.
That's so sick.
But, you know, homeboy trained him.
Yeah.
You know, it forced him into his aesthetics and, you know, and taught him all these things while he's doing that. So, that's when with Jaime, I was all like, you're painting, bro.
Yeah.
From here on out. And he's like, well, how long until I say stop?
Yeah. I mean, it's good. Yeah. Get what's good for you, man. Like,
well, yeah. It's just like, yeah. You're going to do that from here to even when you're not around me.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, like, I draw every single day.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not on an iPad, it's on paper. I mean, when you first came in, there was a sketchbook. It's just sitting right over there.
Yeah.
Because I'm watching a girl who sits next to me, and she's been breaking out a sketchbook and drawing. And I'm like, you know what? Smart I used to book. Do that. I have piles of those books laying around. I used to do early in my career, and I don't do it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, I should get back into that.
Yeah, keep yourself.
Because that just keeps that going.
Yeah, keep your brain sharp.
Yep, keeps it going. You know, because even when I don't know, like, I pick up a thing, and I used to draw, like, every day on paper.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to try to get back into that right now. But I remember, what am I going to draw? And I don't know. And I would just start doing circles.
Yeah.
A series of circles. And just because I was trying to learn how to become a loose drawer. I was always like such a rigid drawer mm-hmm. early in my days. I had to draw it perfect right off the bat. I'd see those people that could do that.
Yeah.
So I wanted to be that person. I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I still can't do it. You know, but like a camera, I can focus way out and start super loose. And then all of a sudden, start drawing one of the doodles. Doodles are amazing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like on the phone style doodle stuff. You know, you're just sketching, you know, and that's what I'll start doing. And then all of a sudden it's like my old Toyota truck out there.
Yeah.
The oil starts to warm up
and then
the engine starts to calm down and it starts to hum. And then it's like, oh, I got an idea.
Yeah. I used to, on that same book, I would do circles. I'd draw practice hand-eye coordination with my circles. And then I really like drawing frogs. So yeah. Like my art book is like, I'm not a good artist at all. I suck at art, but I love doodling.
Do it every day, yeah.
And my book is full of frogs doing things in an American traditional style. Like I have this one Virgin Mary frog. I got Cupid frog. I got frog with a musket. Just I love the frog dynamic of that kind of stuff. It's
there was a trend in tattooing the past few like 5 years. There was
frogs everywhere.
Everywhere.
Oh my
everyone
god,
was doing them.
That's so sick.
So it was really fun to watch.
Like, yeah.
The ones I just saw recently on Instagram where someone put them on their kneecaps and he was able to make his kneecaps.
Yeah.
And made them look like they were riveting.
That's so
and
funny.
I was all, oh, that's such a good idea.
Yeah. Well, how
and
do you
every
feel?
Time I think, I don't know who thought of it. What do you, someone thought of it.
What's like the, I don't know how you probably get asked a lot, but what's like the dumbest tattoo? I guess there's no like, I get, depends how you look at it. There's no dumb tattoo. I mean, there probably are some
there
dumb tattoos, but like what's one that you've done on someone and you're like, dude, I really wish I didn't do that on you.
Most of the time it's doing, like girlfriend, boyfriend names.
Yeah.
I would feel that is my biggest. So there's been the other ones were like, you know, tattooing someone that was in their 70s and like they wanted to top their arm, like,
yeah,
and their skin gets very thin.
Like it's
and
not
you can
work.
Tell, you can usually touch it and try to figure it out.
Yeah.
And I did it and it just lines blew out.
Yeah.
And I was all like, I just felt so bad.
Yeah.
Misspelled tattoos. Most of the time their fault. The last two I think I did were my fault.
Oh no.
It happens. I mean, yeah. Most tattooers can't spell.
Yeah.
I flat out tell everybody when they give me words, I'm like, I'm suck at spelling. I was drawing.
Yeah.
And the way I do it to everybody's always the same. And I hand them a drawing. It's like, go through it, make sure it's spelled right.
Yeah.
You know, go through it, make sure it's spelled right. Put the stencil on one more time. Make sure. Because what happens is that people get so excited to get tattooed.
Yeah, that they forget.
That they forget. And I've had people spell their own kids' names wrong.
Oh, no.
And I tattooed them. And they're like, oh, that's wrong. What do you mean that's wrong? You spelled my kid's name wrong. I don't know how to spell your kid's name. I'm sorry. And then I'd pull out the paper that they wrote it on and go, look. And they're like, oh, fuck.
That's so funny.
And that's happened to me two times.
Oh,
where
my
someone
gosh.
Spelled their own kid's name wrong.
That's hilarious.
And I had to charge them more because I had to cover it up. Because I had already did it.
Yeah.
And it was coloring in the tattoo. And they're like, it's wrong.
That's wild.
You know, the other thing is that there was a fad of like people wanting to be books.
Oh, where they get like the giant scriptures.
Huge, like.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All the way down their ribs. Or
I know the common ones, like a scripture.
Yeah.
St. Michael Archangel.
Oh, yeah. That's all the cops.
Yeah. Cerebrus.
Yep.
Cerebrus is a common one. The Doberman is a very common one. I loved it anyways. I was like, fuck it. I'm getting a Doberman.
Oh, I like the Doberman.
I want that one
though.
So fucking
that was
bad.
Like, that was very like.
I love it. I love
like
it. I feel like
late
80s, 80s
early
villain.
90s.
Yeah.
I've always liked the Doberman. I'm glad they're kind of coming back around. I have
you know,
a couple of my line drawings.
I almost, you know how you drew me the first Doberman and he looked all cute? And I was like, no, you need to make him angrier.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I kind of wish I got the cuter Doberman now. Like, I thought that'd be hilarious to have that. Like,
yeah,
I luckily have no regrets on my tattoos.
Like salt and pepper, you know?
Yeah, dude. Like, this one's still one of my favorites. My family hates this one so much, and I love it.
Is it a kite? What was it?
It was the from the Above the Influence commercial, like
it.
The anti-drug,
okay, yeah.
And no one has this tattoo.
No.
And I'm very happy I went with this one, because this is, I went back to my Instagram. And when I was in high school, I put up a photo. I was like, this is going to be one of my first tattoos. And I have it now. And it's my favorite one. It's my
awesome.
Daughter loves it, too. So like, that's a plus. She says her favorite one is the Cupid doll.
The Cupid doll?
Yeah. And I was like, a lot of people, when they ask me, a lot of people like the work that you've done on this. And I always get compliments on it. And
oh, good.
I like to let them know. I was like, I didn't even plan to get the little baby. I think you added that. And I was like, yeah, fuck it. Let's do it.
Cause like the Cupid?
Yeah, because I only wanted the heart. And you're like, what do you think about the baby then? And I was like, yeah, fuck it. Let's do it.
Did I already have it drawn? I don't even know.
Dude, I just like, I said anatomical heart. And you're like, all right. And it's like, what do you think about a Kewpie added to it? I'm like,
And
I was like, fuck it.
I probably said a cherub and I switched it to a Kewpie.
And I was like,
I was having a thing like, I want to draw a Kewpie right now.
Yeah, you were feeling it. You're feeling that vibe. And it was like such a classic one too. And like, I get compliments on that one a lot.
That too, that comes from a lot of tattooers back in the day worked very closely with carnies.
Oh, wow.
So this if you read about Bowery stuff, like, and that was my attraction to like kind of like a tattoo is like, you know, I love that kind of lifestyle.
Yeah.
And to be a barker was to sell. And it was one of the early things I was taught was sell a tattoo, you know? And I remember my mentor telling me, he's like, most people kind of don't know what they want, you know, and you could almost tell them.
What
you know, what to get.
Yeah, guide them.
You know, and it's that's exactly what I realized is what she was what she meant by that was like, you know, you just have to say like, no, like, this is classic, won't go out of style. You know, like, and it's good. And usually, I would say 98% of the time they're happy with it.
Yeah, dude, it's like there's not like for sure. I like to go with the flow, and I love like I love how all of them turn out. There are tattoos where I personally want to be a specific way. Like, I still want to get my cat JoJo on this side with a tinfoil hat on.
Yes.
I think that would be so fucking sick to have. And, like, that one, I'm trying to visualize how that would look, you know? And that one's like a, I want him with his fangs out. And, like, you know, some there's some tattoos that are just, you know, like, you just want them that specific way.
Yeah, no, and that's fine, but that's our job.
Yeah, true. I do see a lot of times where, like, some tattoo artists get upset when they someone comes in and they want a specific tattoo.
Yes, because they're not versatile.
Oh, okay. Do you think they're just not confident in their skill level to be like, shit, this person wants a Japanese traditional that I can't do?
Lots of different reasons. There's some people I feel like they'll do stuff and they're like, no, I only want to do this style. I've worked with some people that had huge anxieties around walk-in tattoos. And the walk-in style is like the person off the street. And they hand you a bubblegum wrapper. And I want that tattooed on me. And they're like, and they don't know how to do it. Or they're not confident. Or that's not in the style I do. Like, and as a street shop tattooer, the way I was brought up was like, you have to be able to try to. Right on schedule.
Keeping that in.
Yeah. Is you have to be able to at least mimic all styles.
Yeah, you gotta be.
And I tell everyone too, it's like, so I don't do like super traditional Japanese tattoos.
Yeah,
like there's so many aspects and things that have to go together and the way you do it to make it correct. I go, I'll give you my version that's incorrect, you know, but it's a version. You know, and that's how I'll explain it to them. That's so the same comes in, you know, it's just like, and I don't understand, like, why don't people just tell other people that?
Yeah.
You know, one of the other guys at the shop, I've been really trying to push that on him, like, you know, and, and it's been working for him.
That's good.
You know, that he's like, oh, that's cool. Do you want to check this out, though?
That's a
good and that's what I do. It's like, my trick is that I will draw their tattoo exactly how they say. And then I'll draw the way I think.
Yeah, and you would give me alternatives.
And I might come with a third.
Yeah.
And it's different, maybe a mash between theirs and mine. And go, okay, here's yours. Oh, by the way, I did this and this. And they'll look at theirs, and then they'll look at mine, and they're like, I didn't think of that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I know, but this is what I do day in and day out. So I did think of it, and this is what I want to offer you. And it'll make me happier to tattoo this. I'll be just as happy to tattoo yours, but I'd be happier to do this because then I'll feel good when you walk out the door.
That's sick.
So.
Hell yeah. Is there anything you want to say? Or any advice you'd like to give anyone who's trying?
Well, anyone who's trying is, well, first of all, you're, it's a saturated world.
Yeah.
So draw first.
Yeah.
Paint first. Because at least you'll walk out with a skill if tattooing doesn't work, you know.
I feel like there was a huge surge where tattooing really was super, super popular.
Yeah. It probably has to do with how much they air tattoo TV shows.
Who knows? Like, that's the things, like, people ask me, do you watch those shows, Mom? What do you do for a living? They're like, oh, plumber. Do you watch shows about plumbers? No, I'm like, exactly.
You know, that's
I don't
funny
watch those shows.
Because skateboarding's one of those ones, like, where, like, if you're a skateboarder, you're, like, constantly watching things about skateboarding.
Oh, I still watch videos on skateboarding. Yeah, I
love
that. I have, like, three friends that we switch stuff. And, like, yeah. I think only one of us out of three still skates.
And that's
we,
so sick.
But anytime someone does some new crazy trick, oh, my God, did you see that?
They're still doing it.
Like,
they're still
was, like,
doing
still, like, evolving. Like,
yeah. It's
blowing my mind.
It's
know?
A crazy thing.
But no, with tattooing, it's, like, they – I had a friend of mine, my friend Little D, I was talking about. He was on Ink Masters.
Oh, wow.
Season 8, I think. I've never watched it. Mm-hmm. I actually do want to watch it. I do want to see it.
Yeah.
I want to see him on there.
I remember it popping up as a kid on TV.
Yeah. So and it's like, this was like season 8.
Whoa.
So it's been, you know, it's probably like, what, like probably 4 or 5 years ago now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you go to the shows and they're all there with their giant banners.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, yeah.
You know, I feel like if you're on the show, even if you don't make it, like,
you get that advertisement.
You get the advertisement.
Yeah. Because they didn't just pick up random people, right?
You. They own you.
Really?
Like, me and Little D would go out, and he'd put on this hat, and he'd put on this big pennant that he wore,
mm-hmm.
and this vest. And I didn't think about it the first time. The second time we went out again, and then he put it back on. And then he did it the third time, and we were, like, going to a convention in Tennessee. And I was like, yo, man, what's up with the outfit? Like, you keep wearing the same fucking thing. I'm like, I kind of, the hat I get,
yeah.
you know, but the pendant and the vest. And he's like, oh, bro. He's like, I was on that show. And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, so I'm under my contract for the next, I think he said like 1 year or 2 years.
Oh, my God.
I have to wear this outfit when I'm in public.
No way.
I was all, what? And he's like, yeah. And he's like, it's in case I get a call back. Or if I'm recognized on the street, I have to look like what I did.
That's a
on
trip.
The show.
Wow. And some of those dudes, from what I saw, looked crazy. Like, they looked crazy.
Yeah.
Did so, they, like, I don't know if they dressed themselves up. That was like my first inclination of what a tattoo artist looked like. It was always someone who had crazy, whether it was good or bad, style. Like,
yes.
But I was also used to it because the skateboarding world was like that too. That people would have crazy styles.
Yeah.
Like, people would dress a specific way.
Well, look at early 90s and the giant baggy pants.
Oh, yeah, dude's making a comeback.
Tiny wheels.
I got these bad boys at Goodwill, and I'm like, this is the baggiest pants I've worn since high school.
Yeah, just wear some Ben Davis,
yeah.
man. That's what I grew up in.
Oh,
those
yeah.
things were huge.
Yeah, Ben Davis is popular.
Yeah. But still is in my world.
That's right now, I think.
But I just never let it go. That was just because all the cholos in my neighborhood.
Yeah. I think a lot of skaters are wearing, like, Carhartts trying to do a thing. I don't know. I've kind of been out of it since I, like, stopped the shop. Like,
yeah.
Sometimes it's kind of hard for me to even step on a skateboard without feeling a little emotional about it.
Yeah.
It's just, like, it's a piece of me that I love so much. But I kind of, like, been staying away from the sales version of skateboarding. It's kind of like I've gotten, like, a bad taste in my mouth. And I'm like, I'm kind of done with that.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, like, it's like anything out there,
yeah.
you know, like tattooing, that industry has been flooded
yeah.
by non-tattooers selling stuff to tattooers.
Whoa. Like,
so
corporate
I always buy from artist-owned companies.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Always.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, that's the way it was taught to me a long time ago. Like,
yeah. Support your own.
Support your own or support within, you know, and some of those early companies, they were the very first ones, but
yeah.
they were run
There's
by
certain
tattooers,
things like you can't control,
you know,
like I'm trying to think of brands that are not in that field, but they've made some things like Yamaha. I don't think they've made a tattoo machine, but Yamaha is one of those companies that just like makes multiple things. And
yeah.
sometimes they're a hit. Like they've just,
yeah.
they knew how to make a keyboard and a dirt bike. Like who would have thought Yamaha could do that? Like,
yeah.
I know there's companies out there like that, but like, I think with like tattooing and like with skateboarding, it's really hard for them. The consumer still gets them. Don't get me wrong, but I think it's, if you're really into that medium, it's, you kind of see the pitfalls that they're doing.
Yeah. Well, they're just leeches in the industry.
Yeah. yeah. And I
know people like go for it and people want, you know, maybe they grew up on those shows and they
mm-hmm.
see the glitz, the glamour, the lights, and they're like, And they're like, oh, that's part of it. That's what I want to be.
Yeah.
So then someone says, oh, you want to be sponsored by us.
You know, yeah, now you've got to use their gear. And then
like, you got to use their gear. And yeah. I always like, my biggest things, I like to refer to the movie Idiocracy.
I love that movie.
And that dude just keeps saying, you know, what was it he kept saying?
The Gatorade one?
It was like, was it the Whopper? Or he was saying, he kept saying something over. Why does he keep saying that? He goes, oh, he gets paid every time he says it, idiot. And I was just all like, and I go, I feel like that. I get that. I'm like, God damn, dude. Yeah. Like every time you're Gatorade talking, you're like,
that's the hydration they need.
Yeah. It's what plants crave.
Yeah, it's what plants crave. Yeah. Such a good movie, dude. I watched that movie when I was a little kid, and I was like, this is my future.
I watch it about once a year.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it just becomes more and more it's really scary.
It's eerie.
Mike Nelson even said, he's like, I didn't think my movie would turn into a documentary.
Yeah. That's too good.
But that's part of the biggest part of our industry right now. It is because it is expanding.
Yeah.
And because a lot of people are kind of getting into tattooing and through different avenues. Yeah. I won't even go into tattoo schools. Like,
yeah, that sounds like a whole pickle.
You know, that's a whole different thing. But it's like, so they're missing out on some of these traditions, some of these, you know, moral compass.
That's
why you do things a certain way.
That's one of the things that really wanted me to try it too, was I love the idea of an apprenticeship.
Yeah.
And like the hand-me-down aspect of like, hey, the rite of passage to get where you're at. It wasn't like someone, I could read all these things about it. I could read how to do a line. I could watch videos on how to pull lines and like do that. But like the experience of having to go through, whether it be bad or good, cleaning up a shop, doing the dirty work, and then slowly
start learning things. Yeah,
you get adjusted to the environment, and then you're like, you don't touch a needle for 3 months, but you've seen a needle impact so many skins, and you start to visualize what it is, and you're like getting hungry for it, and you're like, I'm thinking about it.
You just know that every day you're learning something. It's just like, even when I worked with my second mentor, Miss Mickey, for I think 5 years. It was 4 years. I think it was 4 years and change. I stuck by her side. I followed her to 2 shops, and then she decided to move back to Portland, where she was originally from. She did this whole cycle. She was in L.A., Huntington Beach. Like, she tattooed all these places, and then her dad was becoming older, and she decided to go back home. And I didn't follow her there. Speaking of tattoo schools and oversaturation, that was a place that I was like, man, no, I got to call it here.
Yeah.
You know, but I followed her because there was so much I could learn from her. And I still do. Like when I go visit her, like the last time I was up in her shop and I tattooed, like I think one day, did I even tattoo? I might not even tattoo. I think with the visitor, it was the end of the night and she was closed up shop. And she was, all right, grab the trash, go do this, go that. And I just automatically was all like,
let's go.
And I was all like, oh. Like, wait a minute, I've been tattooing for fucking ever, and she's been tattooing forever.
Yeah.
But it was just like instinctual. Just like, go do this. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, well, she gave me this life.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm still respectful, you know, to, and I'm still appreciative to her.
Yeah.
All these years later, because without her, I would not be here.
Yeah.
I don't know where I'd be, but I wouldn't be here.
That's super.
And good. I don't know if I would, where it could have went. Because I've watched other people get apprenticeship with someone who was not that good and watched their pitfalls. And, you know, there was my buddy who was doing an apprenticeship, paid for it.
Dang.
Right? And then I remember we were all hanging out with us, and he brought out his drawing. He's like, check out my drawing. And everyone's like, yeah, that's rad, that's rad. And then he looked at me. And I wasn't saying nothing. I was just sitting back. And he's all like, what do you think? And I'm all, it sucks. And he's just all, what? I'm all, it sucks. And I'm like, you're doing an apprenticeship? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, the fuck you do with color pencils? This is not the 90s.
Yeah.
I go, did you mean to do that with color pencils? And he's all, no. I mean, what else do you do? And I'm like, what do you mean, what else? Watercolor.
Yeah.
And he's all like, oh, I don't know how to watercolor. And I'm all like, wait, you're doing an apprenticeship and you don't know how to watercolor? Does the guy teaching you know how to do it? And he's like, no, he doesn't. I'm all, what the fuck, dude? Like, man, this is bullshit. Come to my shop tomorrow.
Yeah.
And he came. I was like, I can teach you how to watercolor in 20 minutes. You have everything else.
Yeah.
You just need techniques.
Mm-hmm.
And I just drew random shapes, showed him, pool water, push water, soaking paper, all these little things. I'm all, now go do like 100 paintings.
Yeah.
And you'll see, like, you'll catch it.
Yeah.
And, you know, to this day, he's like, oh, my God, thank you so much for that. I was like, yeah, dude. And he goes, why do you think I ripped you on your fucking drawing that you did? Like, the drawing itself was fine.
Yeah.
Like, structure is all right, you know, but, like, the rest of it was garbage.
Mm-hmm.
And it was all, like, you know, like, yeah. You know, the yeah. 90s tattooers could do color pencils, but they did them really good.
Yeah.
You know, it was just like, it's like one of those, like I said, trends. Like,
yeah.
You can tell when you look at something, go, that's from the 90s.
Yeah.
Oh, it's new school and color pencil. Damn, what's up, 80, 94? You know, yeah. Like,
those weird years.
So, yeah, it was like big bold lines, Sharpie lines, and colored pencils and pastel colors.
Like, hell shit. Yeah.
So, what I would tell anybody, yeah, is just fucking draw and paint every day. And if you're going to do anything in life, do it all the way. Don't half-ass it.
Fuck yeah.
Don't. Well, like, it's just a waste of your time and someone else's.
Hell yeah.
And we don't have enough time to waste.
No, we don't. We really don't.
That's why I'll just go out and hurt myself on a mountain bike today.
Fuck yeah.
Am I going to do it again? Fuck yeah. That's like the old skateboarding thing. I was like, well, I'll limp home, lick my wounds, and do it again.
Hell yeah. Well, thank you, Danny. Yeah, I appreciate you doing this episode, guys. I appreciate you guys watching.
Oh, yeah.
And,
camera.
Dude, I hope you have a good time on your tour, and I hope a lot of people come and say hello, and I hope you make some good time.
Good
memories with friends.
Posting stuff on my Instagram about it.
I'll put the Instagram on the...
I ended up with the 360, the 360 camera, and my friends all, oh, you're going to become a vlogger. I'm like, no, I'm not. And then he's all, that's how it starts. Oh, son of a bitch, dude. Like,
that's so funny.
But it probably might, you know.
It's fun. I used to vlog all the time. I have a premium version of this podcast, and I have 3 premium subscribers. It's 99 cents a month.
Yeah.
And I didn't expect anyone to do it, but I got 3 people. So now I make 4 extra episodes of me doing random shit a month that are almost like 30 to 40 minutes long.
And, there you go.
And it's fun because I just do random shit.
Yeah, and it's fun.
Yeah.
So I might turn into a vlogger. I don't know. Yeah.
That'd be dope.
Just talk about life, the universe, and everything. And
fuck yeah, dude.
Things on 2 wheels.
Hell yeah.
It's like the Zen, what is it? The Zen of motorcycles? The art of Zen of motorcycles? I don't even.
Yeah.
It's a book. It's a book that came out and I read like when I was younger.
That's dope.
So.
Hell yeah. But thank you, Danny.
I got terrible memory.
It's cheers. All good.